Michael Meade is a renowned storyteller, as many of you probably know, author, and also a scholar of mythology, anthropology, and psychology. He combines hypnotic storytelling, street-savvy perceptiveness, and spellbinding interpretations of ancient myths with a deep knowledge of cross-cultural rituals. One of the reasons that Michael's work has been so powerful for so many communities that he visits is that these insights that he shares and the practices he shares are hard-won in the trenches, mentoring youth, visiting prisons, assisting war veterans, and fostering dialogues among different races and gender. Through story, poetry, and discussion, he's able to find common ground on hostile turf, whether he's working with gangs in Chicago, in the barrios of LA, on Native American reservations, or with Sudanese refugees. He's the author of a number of books that you can find in the lobby afterwards, including Why the World Doesn't End, Fate and Destiny, and The Water of Life. As many people know, he's also the co-editor of the famous poetry collection by Robert Bly, James Hillman, and Michael Meade, The Rag and Bone Shop of the Heart. If you don't own that book, go buy that book. And I would recommend really purchasing any of his books. They will be as transformative to you as this evening will be. Michael is also the founder of the Mosaic Multicultural Foundation based in Seattle, a nonprofit network of artists, activists, and healers who work with oppressed and at-risk populations. He also serves as adjunct faculty at the Pacifica Graduate Institute and is also a regular contributor at the Huffington Post. Now, if that isn't enough, he's also just a remarkably beautiful human being. So please join me in welcoming Michael Meade.
Thank you, Jonah. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
All right. Thank you for coming out on a Friday night. Maybe it's the subject genius. We tried having an evening called 101 Dumb Things You've Already Done. Not many people came. So we said, how about finding your genius? Anyway, it's a joke. So in a way, what I want to do is reintroduce genius in the sense that it was once better understood that the nature and purpose of education was to unveil and make more clear the genius in each person. And that was one of the essential roles of culture, was to bring out the genius qualities in each person. So what I want to do is tell a story about genius and where how it starts and what the essence of it is and what it leads to when a person finds it, and a little bit what it leads to when a person doesn't find their genius. But I also want to just make various kinds of remarks about it and occasionally read something, because I scratched some things down before coming over here. And I wanted to do it at Stanford because it's such a prestigious university. And university means place of universal knowledge. And so the purpose of a university is to bring together knowledge of all different things. And the reason why you need universal knowledge is because each student has their own genius, and you have to have a universal kind of grasp of knowledge in order to teach and bring out the genius in the students. That's my understanding of it. And so I want to do it here because it's a prestigious university, but also because it's in proximity of Silicon Valley, which has its own genius. But I'm not sure necessarily what the combination of them can do. But what I'm interested in is getting back into the culture, the idea that every child born brings genius into the world, and culture's role is to help that child find it so that they don't wind up in despair, either hurting themselves or hurting others, and I'll come back to that in a minute. But just to say, I'm reintroducing it because it's my sense that it's no longer understood. For instance, I had to go out and get a phone. So I went into a phone store, and they had a lot of phones. And I said, so what's all this? And they said, well, you can get a smartphone or you can get an iPhone. So I said, well, how smart is the smartphone? And they didn't get it. So I said, what's the iPhone? What does I mean? And the guy said, I'm not sure. And someone else said, intelligence, stupid. So I said, okay, are you offering a smartphone and an intelligent phone? What's the difference between them? And he started to talk about the technology. And I said, I don't mean the phones, the difference between smart and intelligence. Anyway, he said, next customer. But I said, no, I really need a phone, so what should I do? And he said, why don't you get the smartphone, because it has a genius button. So I thought I'd better give a talk about genius to clarify the fact that you cannot get anything with a genius button, that it's a misapplication of the notion and meaning of genius. So anyway, that's just my phone story. So to be clear, genius has very little to do with virtual stuff. It has to do with vertical stuff. Genius is about the vertical upward capacity of human intelligence, spirit, and imagination, but also about the vertical downward capacity of human imagination and thought to grasp the entire size of the world on a vertical level, not on a horizontal or virtual level. Are you following me? What's going on now is the world has become flat again, and everybody's connected horizontally and in some sense more superficially through the World Wide Web, but the job of humans was to be in the middle of the world vertically and therefore connecting the brilliance of heaven with the depths of earth. And when a person is connected upward in that way, imagination downward in that way to the depths of the soul, then their genius can manifest. So genius is about verticality, the opposite about horizontal spreading of information, and more about the vertical up and down of knowledge, but also of passion, and so on. So I feel we need more verticality in the midst of all the horizontal connectivity. So I also grabbed some proverbs and quotes about genius. Do you know what proverbs are? They're like vitamins for the mind. Threads of genius are present in everyone, but only become visible when something creative is attempted. So what I'm hoping to do is hit a number of ideas and qualities about genius and my kind of hope is that each of you will take something home to use about your own genius or to use in dealing with younger people who are in a quest for genius even if they don't know it. So that's William Blake saying that the genius and purpose are in each life but only become kind of conscious if something creative is attempted. So one reason to do anything creative is to intensify or further awaken the genius and the purpose, and the two of those are connected in the depths of a person's soul. Blake also said this, a wise person has a pattern or design in their mind into which everything they know fits, into which everything they don't know could fit. There's a design, there's a pattern in each one of us that can really take in the world. This is why a human is a remarkable thing, because the pattern inside us can understand the manifold qualities of the world. I'm trying to talk about how big the interior, imaginal soul, and genius nature of a person is, because as the world gets more confusing and more chaotic, a person has to turn somewhere. And I think it's helpful to know that inside is this huge capacity to understand even the terror and tragedy of the world. But if a person doesn't know it's in there, then a person will continue to look outside and find more and more trouble these days. Dryden, English poet. Genius must be born, for it can never be taught. The genius in us already knows why we're here. And when it's awake, we don't have to be taught that. The purpose of education and learning is to help us carry the knowledge we already have once it awakens. I'm putting out a different idea of the approaches of education, where the idea is not to get a career through life, but the idea is to awaken to the purpose one came to live. And that's already seated inside. This is my argument, but it's really the old argument of all cultures until modern times. Emerson, American philosopher, poet. When nature has work to be done, she creates a genius to do it. Therefore, genius is connected to nature, secretly connected to the world and to the ever-changing world of nature. You could say genius is one's own inner nature, and when a person knows their inner nature, they have a natural connection to great nature. So one way culture finds its way back to nature is by having more awakened genius in its people, because there'll be automatic connection back to nature. Oscar Wilde, who was always commenting on the weaknesses of culture, said, "The public is wonderfully tolerant and they're forgiving about everything but genius." You know, he was quite a genius and he got a lot of grief for it. So that's just a warning. Because what happens if you happen to be living in a culture where most people do not know their genius and you happen to manifest yours, they all get upset because you're reminding them that they haven't found theirs. Am I making sense? Okay. So what I've been thinking partially, tonight's also about stories and myth. Stories, the narrative intelligence, is part of the natural genius of human beings. Our natural way of understanding is narrative or through story. Or as a poet once said, this world is not made of molecules, it's made of stories. I mean, look at everybody has been paying attention for several days now to the story in Boston. You can't turn away from it because it's a story unfolding before our eyes. Unfortunately, a tragic story. But we're in the time of tragic stories, and I want to say something about that. The background for this consideration of genius is really the rattling of culture and the disruption of the world. We're living in a time that is very unusual in the sense that culture is in a maybe unraveling, and nature is rattling. We don't just have one problem, we have pretty much every problem you could imagine, and we have it at the same time. What happens then, it becomes difficult to turn outside looking for stability or looking for peace or even looking for orientation, because outside you have Newtown and the needless, mindless slaughter of children. Outside, you have Boston and the bombing of the marathon. And so you have chaos and threat outside. And then if you happen to get a kind of Freudian education, then you think inside is something you need to stay away from also, correct? Yeah. Remember Freud? He said inside is a primal horde waiting to rise up and kill you. You know, that's why you have to thank God for Jung. The student often sees the weakness in the teacher. And Jung said, inside is the divine waiting to awaken and redeem you. So if you have a choice, I'd say go the Jungian direction. But the problem is the modern American person typically does not know that there's something inside and it's been there all along and it's beneficial. In fact, it's necessary for having a fulfilled life. Most people think there might be nothing in there and there's chaos outside, and so you get people getting more and more scared and more uncertain and more addicted and more despairing. Just not to upset you, but that's how it looks. So what I want to say by reintroducing genius is the hidden nature of each person, and it is always waiting to be found. And that reminds me of another person, and who was that? Adversity reveals genius, prosperity conceals it. That's Jung. So he's saying when we get in trouble, our genius is closer to becoming conscious. And when we're very comfortable and everything's okay, we tend to forget our genius and become a little bit too much lounging in the world. The genius wants activity. It's connected to the stars. It's connected to a spark, and it wants to burn, and it wants to make, and it wants to create, and it has gifts to give. That's the nature of it. But in a world like this, where it gets more and more coherent, if people don't know there's something inside worth seeking, people can turn, I don't know, away from both the outer world and away from the possibility of redemption and growth from within. So these are my reasons for trying to reintroduce genius. And so I want to add a poet or two, because poems are part of the genius of the human spirit or the human soul. The natural speech of the soul is poetry. And what we're used to now as speech is a little bit distant from the soul. The soul speaks naturally in poetry, and the poets are there in order to give refined expression to what's being spoken in everybody's souls. And this is William Stafford. And here I'm talking about being lost in the world, because if a person doesn't know that there's something valuable inside, they can fall into despair, or into nihilism is the old word for it, into nothingness. And that's what happens before someone goes in and shoots a bunch of children, or before someone explodes bombs and kills people they don't know. They've fallen out of the world, and they've fallen into nihil, into nothing, into nihilism. That's the only way they can do it. Or if you want to put it in a tribal sense, they've lost their soul before they do that. This is William Stafford. Everybody gets lost in the world. As a matter of fact, we have to get lost to be found. And being lost is all right as long as a person knows that there's someone or something's going to find them. And this is Stafford talking about that. What happens when you get lost? Out in the mountains, nobody gives you anything. And you learn what the rules are after the game is over. And by then, it is already night, and it doesn't make any difference what anyone else is thinking or doing. You have to turn into an Indian. And then you remember stories and know that the tellers were part of all they said, and everyone is, even you. And they are all around you. And if you're afraid, too afraid, you will never find them. And those questions people used to ask, what would you do if? They have their own answer now. Nothing. Listen. Some things cannot be redeemed in a hurry, no matter about good intentions. What could have been done had to have happened a long time ago, for in this world, mistakes have real consequences that do not simply disappear. Listen, if evil could simply be canceled, it wouldn't be very evil. Meanwhile, the stars that you see while you drift away have their own courses. They watch you, and they already know your name. So that's the poet saying, you have a name that's inside you, and the stars know your name. And even if you're lost in this world, if you remember your connection to the stars, to the dance of this cosmos, you can find yourself, and you can be like an Indian. Indian means indigenous person. Indigenous means you belong here. And the stars recognize the name inside us, and the name inside us is another reference to the genius. The meaning of genius is the spirit that's already there. And one of the great purposes in life is to find the spirit that's already in us. And I want to tell a story about that. Are you ready for a story?
Yeah.
So this is what I call a folk myth. It's an old Mayan story. So that it would typically be told in southern Mexico and Guatemala, a warm, hot area. And it kind of follows stories I've found in cultures all over the world, which are about the gifts and the genius and the talents that come into the world with each child born. And like I say, the modern world is not sure that that's happened. The modern world is the world. They call it the accidental universe. It's an accident. If it's an accident and we're born into it, that makes us an accident. If we're an accident, how do we ever find out why we're here? If you go back to the old stories, they say it's not an accident. The soul comes in with a project, and it comes in with the genius to enact that project. And this is an old story from that Guatemala, Mayan, southern Mexico area. Can you hear me over the drum? Is it clear in the back? Yeah? So once upon a time, once, not in this time, but in some other time, once before digital time, once when time still had a rhythm and you could be caught in it and you could roll with the flow of the world, once in that time, there was a village, and in the village, there was a woman, and she was about to become a mother, and the way that she was going to become a mother was by giving birth to her first child. And she had just entered the labor of that giving birth. And she knew she needed help. So she sent word for the midwife to come. And of course, the midwife quickly came. And the midwife began to help the woman as she went deeper into the labor. For a labor is required for anyone to be born into this world. After a time, the moment came for the child to be born, what they call the crowning moment, when this hidden crown of the child breaks from the inner world into the outer world. And at that moment, of course, the mother was wrapped up in the pains of labor and in the effort of it. And so she didn't notice the nature of the child she gave birth to. Everyone else there was so involved with helping the mother, they couldn't see really the child that came out. The only one who saw clearly what happened was the midwife, and the midwife had what used to be called second sight, so that she not only saw the fact that this child being born, this first child of that young mother, was a boy, she also saw that that boy came into this world bearing gifts. That is to say, the child that was born in that crowning moment had a green cape on its shoulders, and it had a gourd in its hand that was full of water. And the midwife saw these gifts that came into the world when that child was born. And she quietly took the green cape off the shoulders of the newborn, and she took the gourd full of water from its hand, and she hid those things. And then she went back and continued to help the mother. And everyone was relieved that the mother was healthy after the birth, and the child looked healthy as well. And then they put the child together with the mother, and everyone began to be quiet, for they used to leave the mother and child alone for 6 or 7 days so that they could find out about each other on the outside, the way they already knew each other on the inside. And then after 7 days, everyone came to the hut of that woman in order to celebrate the birth, the health of the mother, but also to give a name to the child. And it used to be that everyone in the village would come and give the name to the child in order to celebrate that child, because people knew that each child came into the world bearing gifts, and they wanted each child to learn to give those gifts, because after all, when the children were given their gifts, all the people in the village would be on the receiving end of those gifts. So they had a personal interest in the children learning their gifts. Anyway, they all came to celebrate and to have the naming ceremony. And so when everyone arrived, the name was given to the boy who was born on that day, and they gave him the name of Poder. Poder, which means ability. Poder, which means power. Poder, which means fortune, which means luck. Poder, which means fortune. They gave him that fortunate name. And when they gave it to them, everyone in the village repeated the name as if to make it real and as if to penetrate it into his little body, saying Poder loudly, saying Poder very softly, until it echoed all through the village. Poder had come to join everyone there. And once the ceremony was over, everyone went back to their places, and the midwife went to where she had hidden the gifts of Poder, the green cape and the gourd with water, and she took them and she left the village, and she walked out into the holy hills that extended beyond the village. And when she went out there, she found some people, and she gave them the gifts that had been born with that child. And those people took the gifts, and then they hid them away out there in the holy hills. And the midwife went back, and the mother nursed a child, and the child grew in the way that all children grow. And since it was a healthy child, he grew quickly, and he grew well. Oh, yes, he had his rough days, and he had his good days, like any child being born into the world. That's the way of this world, is to have hard times and to have good times. And that's what happened to Poder as he grew and as he prospered as a child, being affectionately cared for by his family and by the village. And we will leave him there in the period of his growth, in the absence of his gifts, in the presence of the attention of his village, until we ourselves come back again to this story later. So that's part one of the story. It's a birth story, it's a beginning story, it's a gift story, it's a genius story. And what they're trying to do, as happened in many cultures, is show this idea that each child that's born has poder. Poder is every child. That's what they're trying to say. Poder is also the Christ child. Notice the Christ story is exactly that. The one who comes in with the gifts. The one who the stars led the wise men to. It's all the same story. Some people make it into a religion, but it also could be a living practice of learning and finding one's stories and then one's gifts and then helping others to do the same. At any rate, Poder represents that quality of the gifted child born. And so I want to just make some statements about the gifts and the talents are aspects of the genius. They're not the essence of the genius. In other words, there's a difference between the talent and the genius. Many people have the talent to play, let's say, a piano, and some people have the genius when they're playing the piano, and many of us can tell the difference. You go into a university or a school, and you have many teachers in there, and you also have many employees in there. The teachers bring out the genius in their children, and the employees pick up their checks. You know what I'm saying? It's a bit of a joke. They're all called teachers, but some are teaching, and others are just, you get it? Teachers know that the genius is what's being sought. Genius refers to the spirit that's already there. That's the meaning of it. It's a Latin word, genius, but it really comes from North Africa, where it was pronounced genie. And then you have, in Latin, they say genus loci, the spirit of the place. And so you have school spirit manifested, you know, maybe the football stadium, basketball court. You see the school spirit come out. That's the genius of the place. And then you have, the genius of the person, the inner genius. So sometimes it's called the guardian angel or the inner muse. In Africa, they call it the divine twin. It's the resident spirit of the soul present in each person, and it involves our own individual unique way of seeing life. I want to repeat that. The genius in us involves our unique way of seeing life. William Stafford has that poem about, he calls it the muse. The muse is the feminine term, the genius is the masculine term. They're very similar. But he says in his poem, When I Met My Muse, he says at the end, or she says to him, I am your own way of seeing the world. As long as you look through my vision, everything in this world will be a kind of salvation for you. You can interpret from that one of the ways to salvation, saving oneself from the usual disasters, one of the ways there is to be seeing the world in our own unique way. The notion of the genius, of the resident spirit inside each person, is connected to the idea that each person is unique and never will be repeated. The genius of each one of us is to be already uniquely ourselves. I'm going to repeat it because we live in a world that is ruled by collectivism and by massing, right? We have mass communications. We're right near a lot of the source of that. It's a mass culture. One of the problems with mass culture is it's automatically against the individual. The individual, it means the undivided person. It means the one who found what was supposed to be found inside them and learned how to live it, and therefore they're not divided within themselves. They're not divided from their soul, and they're not divided from their own genius, but they're living with it. And mass culture cannot foster that. It cannot even support it. It tends to go against it. I'm just saying it in case you're finding life difficult. It's always an upstream swim to become a real person, but in a mass culture, you're swimming against ocean waves. As the indwelling spirit of our life, the genius is the source of our true identity. And if it is ignored or remains unrecognized, it becomes the cause of our real identity problems. You get what I'm saying? That the identity we're trying to find and live out is hidden within us. One of the cool things happening in modern culture is Eastern philosophy and Eastern spiritual notions are coming into the West. I think it's a good thing because in the East, they say the knowledge you're looking for is inside. And in the West, everybody thinks it's outside, and that gives rise to the whole advertising business. You know what I'm saying? Everybody constantly trying to sell us stuff to make us into somebody else where we really need the opportunity or take the opportunity to become who we already are. And in the East, the function of meditation and deep reflection and all that is to find the genius within, or they call it the divine within. And if you think of spirit as the genius, as the spirit within a person, spirit has hints of divine in it. Therefore, you could extract the idea everybody has the divine in them, and that's why we respect each other, because each person is carrying something divine. You get what I'm saying? I hope you get what I'm saying. Because this is the reason to make an effort to have a meaningful life, and this is the reason, I think, to teach, and this is the reason to fight for things that are meaningful, is so that people get not the opportunity for outward success. Okay, if you can produce that, good. The opportunity people need, what real success, or the kind I'm talking about, is the opportunity to risk becoming oneself. There's a lot of cultures that say, you know, you always think you begin the world, you enter the world stage left. Did you get that idea? Remember Shakespeare? All the world is but a stage, and we are the players on it. And so we all enter stage left, and then we're all exiting stage right. Did you get that idea? Did you get the memo? No one gets out of this alive. Everybody's headed for the same exit door. And the idea is somewhere on the stage as we're passing through to awaken to the role we came to live. And that awakening involves the recognition of the genius, the mixture of talents and gifts and style and the unique qualities and vision that we brought to the world. To awaken to that in the drama of being on the stage of life before we die. And I've written about this in Fate and Destiny. There are many cultures that say, at the end, there's not this big judgment day. At the end, the question is, did you become yourself? The question is, did you keep the rules? Not did you get straight A's? Not did you get a scholarship? You know, that's not the question. The question is, did you become yourself? And the self that we're supposed to become is seated in us from the beginning, and the old word for it was genius. And so the idea is everybody's already won the lottery in the sense that everybody has this genius inside, and the question is, can we awaken it and then learn to live with it? Because it's a demanding thing once you have found it. Genus and genius are like two opposite things. Genus is the group, the species. Genius is the unique exception to that. So the idea is somewhere in life to become the distinctly different individual from others. There's periods in youth and growing up where you want to be like everybody else. It's kind of a stage. And somewhere in there, though, something starts to turn. It happens in youth when a person starts to try to figure out, who am I really? And that's a question about the genius. So just to state it again, the resident spirit of the soul, the genius, combines the inherent gifts and talents born with us, as well as the inner inclinations and the style that gives shape to one's character from within. So the idea isn't to develop character like they say. Usually they're talking about moral character. What they mean is you follow certain ideas and then someone says you have character. The idea is to become a character in one's own play. You know, at the end, my sense is no one's going to say, hey, you did a good job, you followed the rules. At the end, they want to know, did you become a really interesting character that no one can forget? That's the idea. We're supposed to have lived in such a unique way that when we go, everybody notices something's missing. I'm trying to make this argument for the individual and the intelligence of the genius of the individual in the midst of the mass culture and in the midst of the chaos and the increasing sense of despair and nihilism about the world, because I think we can only stand against that as unique individuals, and the group cannot manage it. One other idea I put down here. The genius or inner resident of the soul is the keeper of the dream of one's life. So someone once said, a human being is a dream embedded in the soul around which a body is formed. At the center of us is a dream. At the center of us is a story. It's a dream trying to unfold like a play happening on the stage. And it's not predetermined, but there is a plot line. There is something trying to pull us in a direction that has meaning, and that something is tied to the genius. And it also has the quality of a dream, so that when it's actively happening, we feel like we're in a dream, but we're in the dream of our own life. All right. Are you ready to go on with the story? All right. Where were we? Oh, yeah. Podea was a boy growing in the world. And he did what happens to most young people. He reached that point where childhood had to be left behind. And youth was beginning. And as he reached that point, a question, actually two questions, began to form in his mind. One question was, do I have something to give to this world? And the other was, does this world have something to give to me? And his soul began to burn with these questions, and his mind began to burn with these questions. Do I have something to give, and does the world have something to give to me? Am I here for a reason? And since he couldn't answer it himself, he thought of that midwife that had brought him into the world. For everyone said that she was wise. And so he went to her and said, I'm burning with these two questions. Do I have something to give to the world? And does the world have something to give to me? And the midwife, of course, listened carefully, because she knew that every young person hungers to be heard. But she didn't answer him by saying, well, I don't know. We'll have to take an IQ test. She didn't say, maybe some therapy will help you. She didn't say, let's go get some career counseling. She said, the time has come for you to leave the village and to go out into the world and search for the answer to your questions. For the word questioned comes from the word quest. And everyone, when they become old enough to leave childhood, is ready to go on the real quest of their life. And so she said, it's time for you to go. And so Podea went to his family, to his mother, and to his father, and said, I'm ready to leave now. I'm going out into the world. I'm going out into the holy hills to learn what I can of what I have to give to the world, and whether the world is something to give to me. And so his parents gave him a blessing, like people used to do. And his mother gave him some food. And soon enough, Podea left the village, carrying just a little food and a little water. He left everything he knew. He left everyone he knew. And he walked straight out into the holy hills. And he began to walk out there in the hills. He walked up the hills, and he walked down into the valleys. And as he was going through the hills, wandering, he encountered other young people out there who were also wandering. And he noticed that some of them were in deep trouble, either depressed or completely chaotic. And he took note of that. And he held on to the little food he had in the water. And eventually, however, he walked so far that he had no food left. And he used up all the water, but still, he kept walking and kept questioning his two questions in his mind. And then finally, one day, he came upon some people out there living by some caves. And he went straight to them and said, "Listen, I'm out in this world with some questions, and I'm trying to find the answers to these questions. Do I have something to give to this world, and does this world have something to give to me?" And those people welcomed him, and they brought him in, and they said, "We'll help you, but first you have to eat." And they sat him down, and they gave him food, and they gave him something to drink, and then they said, "Get ready now, because the world has something to give you." And then they brought from the place where they had hidden them his gifts that had been brought to them by the midwife right after he had been born. They brought out that green cape, and they brought out the gourd with water, and they handed it to him. And they said, "These are your gifts that you brought to the world, and now the world is giving them back to you." And he was amazed, of course. And of course had no idea what to do with these gifts that were apparently his, but had just been given to him as well. They were his to begin with, but they were also gifts given to him. And they said, "We're going to send you now with someone who has similar gifts to you, for that person will help you understand what the gifts are, and especially how to give them, for the purpose of the giftedness of each person in this world is to give those gifts to everybody else, and that's what makes this world a beautiful place, and in fact, a sacred place." And so Poder began the training and the learning of the gifts that were his, how to hold them, how to carry them, how to use them, what the purpose of them was, and what the value of his own talents were. And he was a good student. He learned everything. He was as persistent as he was in his learning as he was with his questions. And pretty soon, he knew what to do. And so he thanked his teachers out there in the holy hills, and they gave him blessings. And then he went back to the village. And once he was back in the village, he began to practice the genius and the path of his life, for it turned out that the green cape and the gourd full of water were used to make rain. And because it was such a hot and dry place, it turned out that the genius of those gifts were highly valued by the people. And once Poder had come back, when the clouds came in and the storm clouds gathered above, he would go to his hiding place, pull out his green cape, put it on, pick up the gourd of water, and he would roll up into the clouds. And what's up there, he would use some of the water in the gourd, sprinkle it in the clouds, and that would cause the rain to fall from the clouds, and the rain would fall down and nourish the crops that the people were growing. And everyone had more food, and everyone was nourished and enriched partially by the gifts of Poder and the genius he had brought to the world. And because of that, everyone began to value and admire young Poder and his giftedness and his genius. And he remained humble because he knew there was a purpose for those gifts, and they had been only given to him to give to others. And he would do his work when the clouds came, and the rest of the time he would put his gifts away in the little cave where he kept them, and we will leave him there and his gifts there until we ourselves come back again to the story later. So, second part of the story. Notice part of what happens. The youth has to leave the village, everything he knows and everyone he knows. The end of childhood is the end of the part of living as a function of the family. In a way, it's also an end of the role one had in the village of the charming child or the mischievous child or whatever it was. That has to come to an end. And the movement from the end of childhood to the beginning of a real life, the life of an individual, the life of a person moving purposely in the world, does not happen naturally. The growth from birth to child, whatever age, that's natural. You can see it, how it happens. The body grows and other things grow with it. But the movement from childhood to becoming a fully awakened person is not a natural move simply. It requires some great changes to occur. And so the old idea was youth go on a walkabout. That's what they call it in the Australia, Aboriginals call it. You go walkabout because the world is trying to give you an awareness of your gifts and your genius. Notice his questions. Do I have something to give to the world? That's an essential question. People think young people are out to get stuff for themselves, but if you give them a chance, young people are the most altruistic people I've ever met. I don't care if they're rich or poor. When they have a chance to express and give, they become altruistic. There's something in us that knows we came here to give. The notion is the opposite of a consumer society. The consumer society says we came here to get, and we're going to consume everything there is. That's what mass culture is doing. But the old idea is we came here gifted, and we culture is our way of giving. That's our way of being natural and participating in the natural world. And so there's only one thing wrong you could say with the modern world is that it's backwards. That's the main problem with it. You know what I'm saying? It's like gives you an idea of how to fix it. We need a big turnaround. So I want to say something. I'm trying to put in ideas here and take whatever's useful to you, you know, because it seems to me in a world as confused as the one we live in and as increasingly chaotic and dangerous, a person needs real ideas. Real ideas are connected to imagination. The pairing of ideas and imagination is the original brilliance of the human soul, and it's the exact opposite of an ideology. Do you get what I'm saying? Yeah. Nowadays, people are proud to claim an ideology. Someone came up to me and said, I want to tell you, I have an ideology. And I said, I'm really sorry. You know, I mean, if you can do anything about it, get some imagination, because that will go somewhere. So we need real ideas that have blood in them and imagination that suits our soul. And so the common idea, there's two big ideas about the soul or what's inside a person. And one idea is, I learned it when I was growing up in Catholic school, tabula rasa, and it means empty slate. And that's the dominant idea now, that each person is an empty slate and the world writes on us. And what happens to us, what people think of us, and the things that come to us from the outside, they make us into who we are. That's the modern idea. The old idea is like in this story, we don't enter the world empty. We enter the world gifted and seeded with a natural spirit that's aimed at something and with which a genius that wants to make something of life from within. And so I'm trying to make that difference, because what's secretly in the water of the modern culture is that people enter the world empty. It's a very dangerous idea, because here's what it is. If everybody's empty, then other people can get us to do whatever they want, because there's nothing in us to stand against it. But if we came to do something that's meaningful and that involves giving and making the world a more beautiful, healthy, whatever, lively place, then you become a difficult person to move around and to manipulate. Do you get what I'm saying? And then the story's saying, and all the stories I've found say, that this awareness, this burning desire to learn who I am from the inside out is what happens at the beginning of youth. And that's the point where usually girls and boys would somehow be separated from family and even from village, that means regular everyday life, in order to begin the walkabout of self-revelation. For some people, college and a university can be that. It can be the place where you begin walking about inside the kind of manifestations of universal knowledge in order to figure out which ones are calling to me. That would be the purpose of it. I'll repeat. The general idea is not simply to have a career in life, it's to have a calling in life. That was the old idea. It was called vocation, to be called. Not to choose, but to be chosen by something greater than oneself. And what the calling is calling to is the genius that was in us from the very beginning. Am I making sense?
Yes.
That life isn't this accidental thing, and it's not this series of choices. Yes, we have to make choices. But it is much more meaningful in a person's life to be chosen, to be called, and the calling is trying to awaken the seed of genius already in there. So that starts in youth. And that's why the education of young people becomes a different kind of thing. That's why they call it high school and higher education, is because it's supposed to lift us higher, not just get a career. Am I making sense? Yeah. I'm saying this in the midst of a university for a reason. That the purpose of the university, yes, get all the knowledge you can, get a good career, by all means. That's all cool. But the purpose of the university is to nurture and nourish the spirit already in the young person. And when that's happening, then all the ones coming out of the school are like poder, going out to give their gifts to the world. And yes, we have to get things from the world in order to survive. But the notion that we're here simply to get is a backwards notion based on a misunderstanding of the natural generosity and need to give that's in the soul of everybody. And so I feel like I have to say it kind of emphatically, because I'm amazed at how it has become misunderstood in the world. So it isn't tabula rasa and everybody enters empty. It's everybody's already seated, gifted, and somewhat aimed. And the job of culture is to cultivate what's inside the young person. Another way to understand it, it's the second birth. The first birth is the birth through the body of the mother into the kind of family, and it's the physical birth mostly. And then the second birth is the psychological, emotional, spiritual birth, where what is inside the one born comes out. Am I making sense? The second birth is when what's in us is born into the world. And it has qualities that are the essence of one's life. I also should say, the tendency to get in trouble when one is young is natural, in the sense that it's in trouble that we awaken to who we are. Isn't that what Jung said? Right? Difficulty gives birth to genius. Prosperity tends to cause it to go to sleep. So I don't mean go out and get in really bad trouble. I mean, if you have to. But in Mosaic, we call it the right trouble. The idea is to get into enough trouble that we find the resources that we're already carrying. And there's something about education. You know, the word education comes from the Latin educare, and it means to lead it out. And the it that's trying to be led out is the genius that's already in there. So the first function of all real education is to bring out what's in the child, or in the young person. The other big word in the systems of learning is instruction. Education, instruction. Instruction comes from the Latin verb instructare, and it means to pack it in. So the old idea was you didn't pack it in until after you've let it out. Am I making sense here? Most education has been packing the same stuff into all the children or all the students, whereas the first function was to lead out their unique genius individual qualities and then instruct them in ways that make that enhanced. We have it backwards now. Instruction starts early in school, and it continues through many college careers. It's instruction, putting stuff in, not bringing what's out. Later in life, that causes a big problem, because at certain turning points in life, the questions come back. Who am I? What am I here to do? What am I here to give? And is there something going to be given to me? Now, notice the paradox in the story. Poder already has his gifts, but he doesn't quite have them. They're his gifts, but they have to be given to him by somebody else. They're the thing he brought to the world, but the world has to give it to him. This is the beauty of the whole thing, and why a person can't live their life all by themselves. We need teachers, we need mentors, because they're the ones that awaken in us what's already in there. Am I making sense? That we're in this kind of dynamic bond with other people. And the luck of our life is when we meet people who see the genius in us and do not hesitate, but try and help us recognize what we're already carrying. I'll give you an image. It's an old image. That is to say, in the heart of a person, there's a candle with one little flame, and it's burning, right? We're all burning, aren't we? We understand that to be alive is to be burning. You walk around and it's maybe 70 degrees outside, or maybe now it's down to 60, but we're 98.6. We're on fire, even relative to a hot place like here. We're on fire. That fire is also a flame burning in the heart. It's the flame of intelligence. It's really the flame of our genius, and it only grows in two ways. One, when we recognize it in ourselves and say, I think that's what I'm here to do. And the other one, someone else sees it in us and says, I see that genius in you. I see that. Then it grows. And the growing of that flame is the intensification of one's life and the growing then of the life from within outward. And that's the experience I think that the human soul is here to do. Another poem, this is William Stafford again, and here he's trying to suggest that in the confusion of the world, the trick is to stay in touch with this inner genius of oneself. In this poem, he calls it the thread. There's a thread you follow. It goes amongst things that change, but it doesn't change. People wonder about what you're pursuing in this world, and you have to explain about this thread. It's hard for others to see it, but while you hold it, you can't get lost. Yes, tragedies happen. People get hurt and die. And we all suffer and grow old. Nothing we can do can stop time's unfolding. Just don't ever let go of that thread. So the trick is to find this gradient, this thread that has us tied into the world with a sense of purpose. When we're near it, that's when life makes sense. The further we get from it, the more chaotic it all seems and the less valuable we feel. And so it's a problem. No one else can see it, and yet it's there. We ourselves can't feel it all the time, and yet it's there. This is the requirement for understanding that there is something woven into us that is us threaded into the world long before the World Wide Web. We were threaded to something much more subtle. And that subtlety is our way of feeling the sense of life. And so many poets have written about it. So the second part of the story is about the awakening of genius from within. And it happens both because we begin to look for it and because other people help us find it. And it happens off the map. I want to use that phrase. That to be born into a culture, especially a mass culture, we be given maps. The family gives us a map. Here's how to be successful. The neighborhood gives us a map. Here's how we do it around here. The university gives us a map. The religious groups give us a map. And we wind up with all these maps, but none of those maps are tuned to the genius that's trying to really pull the thread of our lives. And so sometimes, because of danger, because of trying to get out of depression, because of trying to find love, because of trying to be creative, we have to just get off the map, like Podair, and go out in the holy hills. And so in the story, they call it the holy hills. Around here, we call it university, or we call it education or something. The idea used to be, by the way, all education was holy, and all teaching was done in the temple in order to indicate not that it was religious, but that it was all holy, because learning is a holy act. By the way, in Navajo, the term for telling a story is called making it holy. So stories are a holy act, too. Most things that are meaningful to us in terms of learning are also functions of the holy. And I want to say the word holy just like I said the word divine, because until you reach modern times, all cultures understood that each child born was tied to the holy and was carrying the seeds of the divine. And that life is this really sacred walkabout, trying to awaken those seeds and bring them to fruition and then give them to the world, because in the giving, they actually grow more plentiful. When it comes to one's natural gifts, giving them doesn't make them diminish, it increases them. You know, if you're a musician and you can make music, when you make really good music, you are not empty. You begin to get filled with the next big composition. To give one's gifts makes life fuller. And because the gifts of a person are tied back to the eternal or back to the divine, learning how to give them gives us an endless quantity, really, to draw from. So I'm trying to talk about a world that has a greater presence than the world of material things and the world of common expectations. And it seems to me that the world is getting so treacherous and difficult that there becomes more reasons to risk being fully alive as opposed to getting by. this departure from the village, departure from everything we know, one of the names for it is the second adventure. The first adventure is to simply grow up, to step into the world. Nowadays they say, get a life. That's the first adventure, get a life, you know? Try to get a scholarship or get into a school, get married a few times. You know, it's so interesting, why do it once? Have a career and then fail miserably, you know? What was it Carl Jung said? When we fail, the soul throws a party. Nowadays, people think you have to exceed or else, but failure is when the soul reminds us what we're here for, and it's not about simple outer achievement, it's about achieving a kind of an awakened state with what we already brought to the world. So in the soul's journey, in the walkabout, failure is valuable. Anyway, this second attempt, not to just get a life, but to get a full life and a life of awakened purpose and meaning is called the second adventure. And it's connected to what I was talking about before as calling. And for the older folks in the room, I want to say this. The calling starts when we're young. The problem with it is it's a soft voice, and we often don't hear it, especially with the chatter around us and, you know, text messaging happening all the time. It's really hard to hear the voice of the soul because it doesn't text, you know. But anyway, it's there. And so what happens when we get in trouble is it stops the chatter, and sometimes that voice gets through. But often it doesn't get through fully when we're young, and a lot of people live a life not tied to the genius of their own soul. But here's the valuable thing. This is so important, the awakening of one's genius, the moving closer to the living the life of giftedness and purpose is so important that the calling keeps calling, and no matter how old a person is and how close they get to the door of exit, the calling is still calling them. That a person can awaken any place along the path. Am I making sense? That being older is not over the hill if a person is getting tuned to their genius and their giftedness and way of being in the world. As a matter of fact, now that we have the largest proportion of the population in America is over 60, it would be a very good thing if the older folks would be tuning into the calling more, because they also have 75% of the wealth, and they might begin to distribute it better if they were answer their calling rather than holding on to what they got. So I wanted to read another poem, and this is... this is Rumi. Do you know Rumi? Yes. Remember Rumi? 13th century poet, writing in Persia, in Farsi, and then about 10 years ago became the most popular poet in the United States, where hardly any of us speak Farsi. A poet can say something so real and so true that it translates to all languages and everybody gets it. Rumi's one of those. And this is called Two Kinds of Knowledge. This is what the fellow selling me the cell phone didn't get. There are two kinds of intelligence. One acquired as a child in school memorizes facts and concepts from books and from what the teacher says, collecting information from the common sciences and the new ideas. With such an intelligence, you can rise in the world. You get ranked ahead or behind others in regard to your competence in retaining this information. And you can stroll with this intelligence in and out of the fields of knowledge, getting always more marks on your preserving tablets. And there's another kind of tablet, one already completed and preserved inside you. It's a spring box. Oh, it's a spring overflowing its spring box from within. It's a freshness in the center of your chest. This other intelligence does not turn yellow or ever stagnate. It is fluid, and it doesn't move from outside to inside through the conduits of plumbing learning. This second knowledge is a fountainhead from within you, moving and trying to flow out. So again, you get the idea. Instruction and all the knowledge of the world is coming in. and filling us up often with stuff we don't need, but there's a fountain inside trying to open up and pour out. It's not that we don't need learning, we need learning, but we don't need learning to fill the emptiness inside. We need the kind of learning that sustains and nourishes and supports the genius trying to flow out. I'm really trying to make this shift in understanding, and I'm suggesting, simply put, that a return to genius-based education, to education based in bringing out the genius, might bring more bright ideas than we're getting from the way we're going, and it certainly would bring more fulfillment to those who are learning, and it would make for a greater future. If you consider, as I said at the beginning, that culture is unraveling and every area of culture needs help, everything from all the illnesses that are present, homelessness, the increase in poverty as the disparity between the wealthy and the poor grows greater and greater, all the diseases that need to be dealt with, and all of the conflicts in the world, because some people come into the world as peacemakers, and if they are brought to know the genius of their own capacity, they can negotiate between the ideologues. They can help with that, but only if they know that that's their genius, and only if they're given support to live that way. On the other hand, other people come in with knowing things naturally, instinctively, wisely, from inside, from the beginning. They know about rivers, and they know about forests, and they know about ecological systems. They know it from the inside out. And those are the ones that need the education to bring that genius into the healing of nature. And because we live at a time when both nature and culture are in tremendous trouble and disarray, we also live in a time when we need the genius of as many people as possible in order to do the healing and the changing that are necessary to bring culture back into some kind of healthy alliance with nature and to diminish this thing that has taken over the culture. Do you understand that it's only when people do not know that each child is born that they are willing to leave more and more people in poverty? You know what I'm saying? The arguments happening in Washington, D.C. and the Congress over how money should be distributed and all that kind of stuff, those arguments are only supposed to occur after everybody has been fed. You know? As the disparity in the culture grows, the amount of infants and children in poverty is growing faster than any other section of the population. The next fastest, by the way, is the elders. They say you don't judge a culture by its achievement, you judge it by its weakest people. When a culture ignores infants because they don't realize that child that's not being fed, that could be easily fed, this is the richest culture in the world, may be the genius that could figure out how to save forests. You get what I'm saying? You feed them because they're going to give gifts once they grow. And to not understand that is to not be a real culture, because a real culture cultivates the gifts of its own people. So we're in that much trouble. All right. So I get lost in time. One of the interesting things about mythology, which is my real study, is that as you get more involved in myth, myth is timeless. Stories are tied to the timeless, and the more you get involved in it, the more you lose touch with real time. So I really know the time, and I'm thinking, is it time to go back to the story? Because it's not over. Do you know what happens? Anybody? It's interesting to think about what happens and then see the difference between what you think and the story, or the similarity. Because the mind of humans is naturally, intelligently narrative, and we're all trying to figure the end out, and part of us thinks we know it, and then the story may go a different way. Anyway, where were we when we stopped? Where? Oh, yeah. Poder, which means power, which means ability, which means luck, which means fortune. Poder had learned that his fortune and his luck, in a way, was that he could bring the rain down from the clouds. And because he had learned to do it, and because he did it in that old way of simply giving it, everyone loved him, and everyone admired him. Everyone except another young fella in that village. For it happened that that young guy had no idea what his gifts were, or what his talents were, or what his genius might be. For some reason, there was no midwife at his birth, or something happened that caused him to be born so that no one in the entire village knew what he had brought to the world with him. And therefore, no one talked to him about that, and he didn't even know the questions to ask. And so, he was a kind of lost person in the village. And like a lot of lost people, when he saw Poder being the apple of everyone's eye, he wanted to be like Poder. And after a while, when he realized no one was looking at him that way, he simply wanted to be Poder. And so he began to follow Poder all around, secretly. And one day, he saw Poder disappear into the cave where Poder was keeping his green cape and his gourd full of water. And after Poder left, that boy who didn't know his own gifts went into the cave and he explored and looked around and he found the green cape and he found the water. And then he left and he waited there until he saw Poder come back and he watched Poder come out of the cave with the gifts he had seen in there. And he watched Poder put on the cape and then roll up into the clouds. And then he saw the rain coming down and he began to understand Poder's gift. And so later, when Poder had put the gifts back, the boy who didn't know his gifts went into the cave and he stole the cape and the gourd with water. And when the clouds came, he put on the cape and imitating Poder, he rolled up into the clouds and sure enough, it worked and he found himself up there in the storm clouds. But he didn't know what to do after that, for he hadn't seen it. And he had the gourd full of water, so he thought, what the hell? I'll pour the water out. And so he poured all the water into the clouds. And that caused those clouds to begin to rain and to begin to pour down a torrential rain on the village because all of the water had been released and it was drawing all the water in the heavens and the skies. And rain began to pour down on the ground and the earth began to flood and the crops of the people were washed out in the flood. And pretty soon the houses of the people were being washed away. And soon after that, people were drowning in the flood. And that caused people to call out very loud and to scream. And when that didn't change anything, people began to pray out loud. And people must have prayed so loud that the God up in heavens heard the prayers of the people and looked down and saw that the rain was continuing to pour and everything was getting flooded. And so it was God that came down and stopped the rain. And he listened and heard what people were saying. And he realized what had happened is someone had taken the gifts of another person and misused them. And for some reason, that made God angry. And I don't know why it is God gets angry. But then again, he's God. He made everything, so he must have made anger too. And therefore, he could be subject to it. At any rate, God got so angry that he said, from now on, no one will know their gifts when they're born. From now on, even the midwives will not have the second sight. And therefore, people will be born, all of them, without knowing their gifts, and the people around them won't know their gifts. To be gifted is so natural to a human being that God couldn't take the gifts away. He just took away the knowledge of the gifts. And they say that we are the descendants of those people. We are the descendants of Poder. That is to say, we have been born into a world where not only do we not start out knowing our gifts, but the people around us do not see the gifts that we brought to the world either. And therefore, it is easy to wind up wandering in the holy hills, not knowing why we are here and whether we have something to give or whether the world has something to give to us. That's what they say in the village where this story comes from, and they particularly say it when the world around them gets difficult and chaotic and stormy and full of threatening changes, because everybody knows that when the world is really dangerous, one of the best things to know is why we each came here and what we came to give. For in that giving, we can help bring the world back into a healthy balance. That's what they say when they tell their stories. And me, I'm just trying to keep a few stories alive in this world that seems like it could end or fall apart any minute. So thank you. So that's it's a teaching story. It's a teaching story because it's teaching about gifts, and it kind of has teachers in it. And the kind of genre of teaching stories is partly used to help people in times of trouble. Throughout the history of the world, people have gotten trouble over and over again. We happen to be in a big transitional period of great trouble. Like I said, nature and culture in trouble at the same time. It's part of being here. The old idea was that the human soul comes to the world at a time when it has something to give that would help the world. And so I've been working with old stories and old ideas that says no one's going to save the world. There's no bright idea that's going to save the world. There's not going to be any agreement that saves the world because the world is too diverse and people aren't here simply to agree. People are here to shine. And the way the world gets redeemed or saved or brought back into balance, or use your own term, is when more and more people find out why they are here to begin with. That's the beginning of helping. Because in the old stories, people are here to help culture happen, but also to help nature. That we are in that in-between, between nature on one side and culture on the other. We are the production of nature, and we are the producers of culture. We are both, and we are also in the middle in terms of the up and down. We are in the middle between heaven and the energy coming down, and we are standing on the surface of the earth, and in the middle of the energy that goes all the way to the center of the earth, where there is a fire that no one knows the temperature of, just like the fire burning in the heart of humans. We are a replica of this whole thing, and therefore we are capable of helping it find its way back into a more healthy state. That's what the stories say. Me, I'm sticking with them. Because the stories I read about don't have that kind of depth or that kind of a coherence. And so I'm sticking with the old stories that bring this kind of knowledge or this kind of idea. And it seems to me that in a period of great transition, one of the things that could happen is the reinvention of everything, including education. I'm serious when I say that if education was aimed at bringing the genius out of each student, there would be a lot more knowledge and a lot more gifts available for the giving. And that if history could occur in such a way that we have constructed this very limited, I would say, mostly materialistically aimed culture, then history also could alter to the point where we construct a different kind. And I don't mean in some foolish way, but I mean in the way of bringing out what we carry within us. The Greek word for genius was daimon. D-A-E-M-O-N, daimon. And the Greek word, the old Greek word for happiness was eudaimonia, making your demon happy or your diamond happy, that we're happy when our genius is happy. And then daimon is the genius, and when the genius is neglected, it becomes a demon. So a person's worst demons are really their genius turned around. This world is not, what would you call it? There's no neutral in the world. Either a person is growing or they're shrinking. You can't stay in a simple, natural, balanced, middle place very long. The world is about change, and we are part of the world. And so the old saying is, when a person encounters a great obstacle, a great loss, or a great tragedy, only two things can happen. The person can become a bigger person, or they can become a smaller person, right? Because if you came out the same, then it wasn't a big obstacle or a big loss because you came out the same. So whether it's loss or danger or an obstacle, and whether it's the individual or the culture, the way we're going to get through this threat of the various forms of terrorism, the mindless use of weaponry right in the streets, all this kind of hatred that penetrates the culture is by getting bigger. And we can't get bigger except by bringing the stuff inside out. What was the old thing in the Gospel of Thomas? If we bring out what is inside ourselves, we will save ourselves. If we don't bring it out, we will ruin ourselves with what we didn't do. Or as the Native Americans say, if you don't give the idea in your mind, it will rot and take you into rottenness with it. We're here to give, and I'll just restate it. We're here to give what we brought into the world. And we're in this great drama. And we're on the stage of life. And in the Greek drama, the main characters that were in the front of the play and in the center of the story were called the protagonists. the proto-agonists. In a way, to be in the drama is to be in the agony of self-revelation. And that was the protagonist. And then the secondary actors that were back here were called the hypocrites. I love it. Either we step into our story and we struggle to bring out the beauty that we brought into the world, or we join the rest of the hypocrites. That's the deal. And so it wouldn't make any sense, and would be a terrible world, if it wasn't true that everyone who comes in the door of birth is bringing a gift and talents and a unique style and their own genius. If that wasn't true, then this world would be a truly terrible place. But because that is true, everything that happens on the stage of life can be redeemed in some fashion, but especially by the person who is naturally inclined to be helpful in that way. So I'm going to just bring it to a conclusion, but I want to restate this idea that each person is unique. The uniqueness inside us, the old word was the genius. It's the combination of the talents and the gifts and the natural style and our own way of perceiving the world. That combination, called genius in its kind of ensemble, is what makes us really valuable. And the notion was, if we don't live our life in our own unique way, it will never be lived by anyone else. There'll be many other people. Don't worry about that. I have a book out there saying why the world doesn't end. Don't worry. The world's not going to end. It's just going to be in a big mess for a long time. But the way out of the mess is to awaken to this genius quality. It can happen at any age. It's not gender specific. It's not ethnic specific. It's everybody. And that living out that uniqueness is really, it's what Jung called individuation. It's really the purpose of life, not fitting in. Fitting in is a stage, but becoming, oh, and I should mention one other thing. When a person begins to live with their genius, they begin to be truly weird. And so I hope you hear that as a promise. Weird is a Welsh word. Originally spelt W-Y-Y-R-R-D-D, because the Welsh have all those consonants that they don't have in Africa. And weird means to have one foot in each world. That is to say, one foot in the everyday world where you can buy a smartphone, and one foot in the world of true imagination and beauty and genius and imagination that's trying to pour into the world where the phones are smart and the people aren't doing so well.
Thank you.